This time, Dennis Greenhill had no hesitation in recommending the new chief, and Douglas Hume had no hesitation in accepting that recommendation and announcing his decision to Heath. Maurice Oldfield had, at last, acceded to the position of Chief of the Secret Intelligence Service. Chapter 17, M equals C, Part 1. It's unlikely that Maurice Oldfield expected that his elevation to become the fabled C would allow him the anonymity that had been afforded to the majority of his predecessors. Kim Philby had seen to that in 1968 with the publication of his autobiography, even before the unfortunate publicity that precipitated Rennie's departure. It was the same magazine, Stern, that carefully reported Oldfield's appointment, making him the first chief to be named in the press. The Stern report was picked up by the American magazine Newsweek, and the facts repeated. Once that had entered the public domain, the British press reported on that report, and Morris's humble background and remarkable promotion gave all the daily newspapers a cracking story. At that stage, Morris's home address, now a bigger, modern flat, 6 Marsham Court, was still listed in Who's Who, along with his mother's telephone number in Overhaddon. For the first time, too, a picture of the head of MI6 appeared in the press. Though, as it was a slightly blurred shot taken outside Buckingham Palace when he was appointed CBE in 1956, featuring a dark-haired, unsmiling Morris with round, Billy Bunter glasses, anyone seeking out the man himself in 1973 wouldn't have found him easy to identify. For the next 5 years, that was to be the photograph wheeled out every time his name was mentioned. It still features on any number of conspiracy theory websites. The press descended on Overhaddon, expecting to find a host of locals wanting to spill their stories about the man who was by now almost casually being referred to as M.